Have breath, praise ye the Lord. The Lord is good, and his love endures forever. Amen, somebody. Amen, somebody in this place. We just want to set the atmosphere for that is conducive for worship. And as we gather together, I invite you to stand and join with us in some praise songs. How many people know the Lord is good? How many people know the Lord is good and his love and his mercy endures forever? Here we go, let's sing together. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you. You are good. Put your hands together if you know the Lord is good. Let's take it from the top. Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
Sing it with me, Lord.
Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.
We worship you for who you are.
Oh, how many people know the Lord is good? I say again, how many people know the Lord is good? The Lord is good, and his love and his mercy endureth forever. And we just seek the Lord tonight, and we ask that the Lord would prepare us for service, that the Lord would be preparing us to love and serve our neighbor. And so this next song says, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a
sing it again. Lord, prepare.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a
a little bit higher. Lord, prepare.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a
take it up one more time. Lord, prepare.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be
one more time, Lord, prepare.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be.
Sanctuary.
Sanctuary for you. Sanctuary for you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh Lord, prepare us to be a sanctuary for you. Amen, amen. And please remain singing, standing with us and singing with us as we gather together. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not. Thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning within. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I sing. Oh, I have needed thy hand, have provided.
Great is thy faithfulness. Sing that one more time. Great.
Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, run and have provided.
Great is. Say it again. Great is.
Amen. Great is God's faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies we see. And this last song that we're going to sing before we begin our session, it says, I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I am on the battlefield for my Lord, and I promised him that I would serve him till I die. I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. And this is a fun song. We can put our hands together and clap on this one.
Thank you.
I just wanted to hear you put your hands together. Put your hands together.
Here. All right, well, welcome back, everybody. I hope you had a good dinner. I hope you got to meet some new people. And I hope you're now sitting by regions because we have an exercise for you to conduct in your regions. If you need to verify, there is the slide that tells you where you're supposed to be. And what I want you to do. And this is an attempt to facilitate getting to know other people from your region who you might not know. What I want you to do is to find one other person at your table, just one, and we have a question for you to share. And what we're going to do is we're going to have the first one of you share your answer to this question for about 3 minutes, and then we're going to switch, and the second one will share. And it'll just give you an opportunity to get to know someone. And here is the question, okay? So what I want you to do is to identify the one other person. So break up into groups of two. Oh, very good. You're doing that well. Okay, so what I want you to do now is to decide who's going to go first, and the first person needs to answer this question for yourself. In what small or large way have you found hope for changing the politics of hunger? And what I'm going to time you, I'm going to give you 3 minutes, and then I'm going to give you 2 minutes, and then I'm going to tell you have 1 minute left, better finish up. So you have 3 minutes total, and then we're going to switch to the second person to share. Is that clear? Okay, so the question is, in what small or large way have you found hope for changing the politics of hunger? Person number one, go. Should be constructive. Okay, so that's 2 minutes. So you have 1 minute to finish up, person number one. Okay, it's time to switch to the second person for our second person in each pair to begin sharing their answer to this question. Okay, you have about a minute to finish up. That's all right. Okay. Well done, everyone. I hope that gave you a chance to get to know some other people from your area who maybe you didn't know previously and to share some ideas. Now Victor's going to lead us in song again. Victor?
Amen. Amen. Thank you. And as we've been sharing in groups and getting to know one another, this next song is so appropriate because it invites us to lift our hands up and praise together. So I invite you, when we get to the second part of this song, if you would, to raise your hands up and praise, and you are welcome to join your neighbor with your neighbor, and we can all lift our hands together as a beautiful community. Let us all stand and sing this next worship song.
My hands lifted up
and my mouth filled with praise, with a heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee, O Lord. Let's try that. With my hands lifted up, and my mouth filled with praise, with a heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee, O Lord. One more time, let's do that again. With my hands lifted up, and my mouth filled with praise, and a heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. With a heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee, O Lord. 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 I will bless thee, O Lord, with my hands lifted up, with my hands lifted up, and my mouth filled with praise, with a heart of thanksgiving. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord. I will bless thee, O Lord, with a heart of thanksgiving. I will bless thee, O Lord.
Amen, amen. Praise God in his temple.
Amen. You can be seated. Now, you are all sitting by regions. And each region has both its own field organizer and its own regional organizer. And if you haven't met these people, you probably will by the end of the gathering. Holly Hight, who's going to come up and speak next, is the California field organizer with Bread for the World. Yay, Holly. She started with Bread in 2004. When she was an intern with the One Campaign, and she has been instrumental in the development of the videos, which you are about to see, and I think you're really going to like. Holly, you want to come up and introduce these?
Where are my California people? There you are. So I live 20 minutes away from Hollywood. When I was asked to introduce the world premiere of these videos, I found it apropos that Bread chose me, the one person on staff who lives the closest to Hollywood. And it's not lost on me that my name is Holly. Most of you came here today with your minds focused on Capitol Hill. Let me suggest to you that Hollywood and Capitol Hill have a lot more in common than we like to think. On the surface, both Hollywood and Capitol Hill seem shallow and out of touch. But if you go a little deeper, you quickly realize that both are made up of people with real stories. Some of those people love their work, some of them hate it. And unfortunately for us, some of them don't really know how to use Twitter. But let's put aside Capitol Hill for a moment and talk about Tinseltown. Hollywood at its best is about telling good stories. Think about it. Do you remember a movie that moved you so deeply? What I love about movies is that they tap into the full range of human emotions. Grief, anger, triumph, joy, and sadness. Movies often tell our stories in ways that we cannot. And stories contain the power to transform us, to change the way that we think about ourselves, to change the way that we think about our communities, and to change the way that we think about the world. After all, what makes a great movie is a great story. Let's think about a few of these great stories and how they've changed us. West Side Story, The Color Purple, Schindler's List, and the list goes on. What makes a good movie are the countless people who manage the day-to-day details of production. And we really only see these people at one point during the film, and that's during the credits. In the story that is our lives, you are the actor. And the credits are the people who never appear on screen with you. Your parents, your siblings, your friends, coworkers, pastors, and mentors. Tonight, you have an opportunity to meet three amazing people. And this is one of my favorite things about being a Bread for the World organizer, the chance to hear people's stories and hopefully, selfishly, get listed in the credits. You will meet people who are passionate about justice. You will meet people whose lives have changed because of God's grace in Jesus Christ. And you will meet people with struggles, just like you and me. I know that the story of our lives is not lived out in a 2-minute video. It's lived out over a lifetime. Yet I believe that telling our stories creates a situation where God can act as the great director in our lives and in the world. And so, without further ado, allow me to introduce you to our first story. I met Cameron 3 years ago when she came to work as a grassroots intern in our California office. During her internship, Cameron participated in a local lobby visit and organized an event on her campus to raise awareness about hunger. Let's meet Cameron.
A lot of the issues that were impacting Senegal's environment and economy had nothing to do with Senegal. That's what I'm looking at this. Like, the U.S. Farm Bill was not something that was put into place by Senegal. I didn't get the feeling that they had ultimate control over their own economy and many times over what they ate.
My name is Cameron Shaw. I graduated from Pomona College. I had a thrilling experience in Senegal that ignited a longtime passion in hunger and justice issues.
I think one of the highlights for me was that I got to live with a Senegalese host family that I'm still in touch with. I actually talked to them this morning on the phone. And my host father is really interested in studying agricultural patterns and the movement of agricultural goods, and was really surprised that we didn't study that in the United States. The politics of food, I felt, was discussed a lot more than it is in the US, and I was really surprised that people, even people who weren't farmers, would sometimes talk about not just their own government, but international government's impact on food. Right now, I am trying to hopefully get an offering of letters or something done at my church.
I'd be happy if the people in my church just learned about hunger issues. I'd be happy if I could get people to write letters to Congress. I want to communicate to them that right now, when we make laws in the U.S., we think about American citizens. And I understand that the U.S. government is going to think first about its own people. But I don't think that thinking about your own people needs to be mutually exclusive with thinking about people in other countries.
Since this video was made, a lot of changes have happened in Cameron's life. Cameron planned to join us this week, but in early May, she received word about her application to the Peace Corps. She was accepted. And 3 weeks ago, Cameron arrived in Suriname.
We're starting to see people.
Cameron arrived in Suriname for 2 years of service with the Peace Corps. She was placed in a rural community where she is working with farmers to increase access to local markets. The next story comes to us from Dominic Barrett, who lives in Virginia. Dominic was introduced to Bread for the World through our Young Leaders Development Program called the Hunger Justice Leaders. Dominic is a hard guy to miss. He's over 6 feet tall, and he loves to wear bow ties. Let's meet Dominic.
We're starting to see people say, wow, if I want to create change in my neighborhood and in my backyard and in my grocery store, maybe the easiest way for me to do it and the best way for me to do it is not right here in my community, but is in Washington, D.C., or is in my state house. And for me, that's exciting to be able to let people know if we want to create change, we really can create change in our backyard by affecting policy. Shalom Farms, which is our project of United Methodist Urban Ministries of Richmond, is committed to addressing food access in urban Richmond. We have these massive pockets where folks cannot get access to healthy food. And so the farm then leads us into the city. We've got a great partnership with our local food bank, which will come out multiple times a week during harvest, take the food we have coming off the farm and bring it into the community, bring it to the food bank where it'll then be held for our partners across the city to come pick up. Today we had a clergy from across Richmond out there as part of a district clergy meeting.
Say thank you all so much for being here. And for
investing their own time and then also taking that mission and ministry of our work and taking it back to their churches and letting them know not only about the work that we're doing, but letting them know this is a real issue in Richmond and across the country. Food access and food justice is a place of great need and a place of great possibility and great opportunity.
He said it's all going to break down and it's going to release nitrogen.
The on-the-ground work must go hand-in-hand with the broader policy-driven efforts. And so we need policymakers who are informed by these great stories in their local communities, and we need communities that understand that that their voices speak volumes. Our representatives in D.C. are there because we put them there, and they're there representing us. And we don't have to be well-spoken, we don't have to be a policy expert or a policy wonk, we have to say, this is what I'm seeing in my neighborhood, this is what I'm seeing in your district and in your state. At the end of the day, it's about being authentic and speaking very sort of organically from your own experience. And that's what I think what moves people to action.
Dominic could not be here with us today, but he's going to try to make it to Lobby Day on Tuesday. He's part of a slow but growing movement on Capitol Hill to bring back the bow tie. Our next story is from Tina Hayashi, and she is another person who participated in our Young Leaders Program, the Hunger Justice Leaders. Robin, one of our organizers for Tina's region, had this to say about Tina. When I met Tina for the first time, I remember that she didn't understand why she was picked for our training. She met all these amazing people, and she didn't understand why we chose her. Over the past year, Tina has actively committed to anti-hunger advocacy. She has partnered with us in Seattle and on social media. Let's meet Tina.
I remember this one evening, a student was just eating so much food, like more than I've ever seen anyone eat. And then afterwards, and he asked the director if he could take the leftovers from dinner home to his mom, and he said that his mom doesn't have money to buy food for the rest of the month. And I think at that point, I realized that hunger is a real issue in America. Because yeah, it's one thing to just like hear the numbers about hunger, but it's another thing to like actually care about someone who is hungry. equality for everyone. My grandparents and great-grandparents during World War II were affected by the internment camps. They show so much resilience. They've been able to kind of like work through the different issues that have come up as a result of being unfairly treated. We as Christians should be concerned about justice and how government policies are influencing or impacting the rest of the world. I remember stepping into the senators and representatives' offices and just feeling so empowered after leaving that the things that we came to say could make a difference in U.S. policy. When Jesus says to love your neighbor, I think that includes making sure that the government is making decisions that are actually loving towards our fellow neighbors and the rest of the world.
Tina is unable to be with us today, but she is here in spirit and also on Twitter. In August, Tina is moving to San Francisco, where she will serve as a dietetic intern at the University of California, San Francisco, a leading university dedicated to promoting health worldwide. So tonight, we have experienced three incredible stories. And as I said before, many times, these people could not be with us, but I still want them to know how much their stories mean to us. So I need your help. Tonight, we are going to create a video thank you card that we will send to Cameron in Suriname, Dominic in Virginia, and Tina in Seattle, because I want them to know how much we appreciate them. So here's what we're gonna do. I have this little flip camera on me. And once the camera starts rolling, I'm going to speak into the camera as if I'm speaking to the three of them. And after that, I'm going to pan to you, and I will count to three. And I would love for you to yell thank you and clap for them. Are you guys, can you do this? Yeah? Yeah? All right. Are you sure? Okay. All right. All right, let's try this. We'll do a dry run, okay? Hi, Cameron, Tina, and Dominic. We just had a chance to view your stories, and we were so moved by them. Thank you so much for what you do for hungry people and your work of advocacy. But it's not just me who was moved tonight. I'm here with a group of people who want to share their joy and love for you. May you continue to let your life speak. Thanks be to God. I think we got it right the first time. Thank you.
Oh, that's great. Thank you, Holly.
And many thanks, too, to the other staff who put these videos together. They were so beautiful, and they were so different. You know, we all come to this issue of hunger from different places. And these are very different stories. Each of our stories is unique. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, David Beckmann. In addition to being president of Bread for the World, David is also the winner of the 2010 World Food Prize, although David is also always careful to note that the prize was not just for him, but for the members of Bread for the World, for the staff of Bread for the World, for all of us who have been working hard to end hunger. David is also the author of a recent book, Exodus from Hunger, and I know that he has some very important words for us tonight. David?
I really appreciate all of you for coming to this event. I know a lot of you, and you are also amazing people. I really thank God for you. Everybody I know here has been touched by the love of God. You know, you recognize the embrace of God. You are committed to justice for hungry people, and you understand yourselves as leaders in achieving a more just nation and world for hungry people. So I am sure that the 4 days that we are spending together will in fact help to change the politics of hunger on Tuesday, and then as we spread back across the country and continue this work over the coming months and years. I am sure, because of who you are and because of the power of God in our midst. Some of you know that one of my sons, John, has himself struggled with hunger and poverty. John has suffered from the really deadly disease of addiction and alcoholism. It's a self-destructive disease, and just about 2 years ago, exactly 2 years ago today, John really hit bottom. He came out of a weekend in jail. He had 2 quarters. He'd been evicted from his tenement, so he was homeless. And because he was still using, he borrowed somebody's cell phone and called me a number of times, but because he was still using, there was nothing that I could do for him. I mean, think of it, the irony here. I'm trying to end hunger in the world, and my kid was hungry. And there was nothing I could do for John. 2 years later, actually later this month, I'm going to go up and see him, and he will be celebrating 2 years of sobriety. You know, some of you know what it is. He is engaged to be married, and he is supporting his fiance, her name is Megan, and her little boy, Ryder. He is supporting them. She's in a program to become a dental hygienist. And so he is supporting them selling cell phones in a mall. That is not easy. He got a high school diploma, but he didn't go beyond that. So he sells cell phones in a mall. He works on commission. He's one of the people who does know what it means to have daily bread. He gets paid. The cell phones he sells, then he has money. If he doesn't sell, there's no money. And his take-home pay is about $2,500 a month. Supporting 3 people on $2,500 a month means that if anything happens, for example, if his brakes go out, then he and Megan may not be able to buy groceries. He gets some help from his family. She gets some help sometimes from her family. Megan and John have also needed and used public assistance programs. So Megan, until just a few months ago, Megan was getting food stamps. And she also benefited from tax credits for working poor people. Those are both issues that Bread for the World has worked on. So I could see that the work that we were doing last year, when we won, it's made a real difference in the life of this young woman who I'm coming to love. What John needed was a drug enforcement court. And he was really lucky that the place where he chose to sell drugs had a drug enforcement court. So because of that program, there's strict discipline, but they also understand addiction. If it hadn't been for a drug enforcement court, he'd probably still be in prison. So public programs are important. You can tell that I am tremendously proud of my son, John. Tremendously proud. But John has learned through Alcoholics Anonymous to be grateful to God, to give thanks to God. He prays on his knees every morning and every night, and he thanks God for opening doors for him, for helping him stay sober, and for giving him the motivation he needs to be a good worker, a good family person, and a service-oriented person. He helps a lot of other young men who are struggling with addiction. So as we talk about hunger and poverty in America this week, we're talking about people like my son, John. I also want to tell you about some friends on the other side of the world. In February, I got to go to Bangladesh. And my other son, Andrew, bought a plane ticket and went with me. My wife, Janet, and I lived and worked in Bangladesh back in 1976. And we lived in a little town called Takargao, way up in the northwest corner. I haven't been back there since 1976. Back then, I spent a lot of time in a tiny market settlement. Back then, it was about 200 thatched houses. It's called Gorilla. And on this trip, we were able to go out to Gorilla. It's changed completely. It's now a bustling rural commercial center. But we were able to find the man that I lived with when I was in Gorilla. I spent a lot of nights there. My job there was to try to figure out new ways for our agency, which was financed by Lutherans all over the world, how could we better serve rural people? And when I was out there, I stayed with the primary school teacher. His name is Mr. Buddy. And I was able to find Mr. Buddy after 35 years. We were driving in a van up toward where we heard his house was. I couldn't remember. I mean, everything was so changed, it was hard to even find places. But I saw him on the road. So we stopped the van. I got out of the van. I remembered enough Bengali to say, "How are you?" And he embraced me immediately. And he took me by the hand, as Asian men often do, and walked me hand in hand back to his house. And within 5 minutes, there were half a dozen men there that I used to hang out with in 1976. It was a trip. Now, the most exciting part of this, you know, being dropped back down into Gorilla 35 years later, was that the lives of my friends have turned out much, much, much better than anybody could have imagined back in 1976. Mr. Buddy's house is now what they call a paka house. It's a concrete house. He's added some extra rooms for children and things. There used to be this gully outside the house, which was a breeding ground for mosquitoes, which is no joke. And he pointed out to me, you see the gully has been filled. It used to be that Gorilla was cut off during the rainy season. They were isolated. And now there is a tarmac road that goes from Gurria to Takargao. Buses go up and down. So they are connected to the rest of the country all year long. I was really struck that the children look healthier. And it's also mainly because there is more food available, and there are also different kinds of food available in the market. Much more variety than we saw when we lived there. And then most striking is the fact that the status of women in society has clearly changed somewhat. It's not Sweden, but back in 1976, I almost never talked to a woman because they were in the house and they didn't talk to another, they talked to their husbands and their relatives. They didn't talk to another man. On this trip, I met women, I talked to women, and they stand with dignity and with confidence. There are a lot of these little development groups for poor women, and they elect women to be their officers. So I asked Mr. Badi and my other friends, well, you know, how do you assess what's happened to you? And you know what they said? They said, we give thanks to Allah. We give thanks to God. That we have been so, I mean, they're still very poor, but they give thanks to God that their lives have changed so much for the better over the last 35 years. Now, you know that the world as a whole has made unprecedented progress against hunger, poverty, and disease over the last 3 or 4 decades. Unprecedented. In countries as different as Bangladesh and Brazil, Ethiopia, and England, there has been substantial, in fact, dramatic progress against poverty and disease. And I think many of you understand, as I do, that this is God. This is our loving God moving in our own history. Helping people like John, helping people like Mr. Badi, answering their prayers in a big way. I've come to see this as a great exodus in our time and to believe that God is asking us to get with the program to help make it happen. Now, sadly, in our own richly blessed country, we have not made very much progress against poverty over the last 3 or 4 decades. It's why many Americans just have a hard time understanding that the rest of the world's making a lot of progress. It's not that we haven't ever been able to make progress. As I look back at the history of the last 40 years, we have made substantial progress against poverty when we made a national effort, when we tried. Most dramatically in the 1960s and the early 70s, we had strong economic growth. Both Lyndon Johnson and Richard Nixon made serious efforts. The society as a whole was concerned. And during those years, we cut poverty in half in this country. But we haven't made a sustained effort. When I was writing the book, Exodus from Hunger, I was really struck that we haven't had a president since Lyndon Johnson who made reducing poverty one of his top 5 priorities. We have never had a U.S. president who made reducing poverty in the world one of his top 20 priorities. Building political commitment is crucial to the progress against hunger and poverty that God is struggling, longing to achieve. There, too, I think we've seen some momentum. Bread for the World and the growing number of other organizations that are committed to reducing poverty have, in fact, helped to change attitudes. So when Americans are surveyed nowadays, our attitudes toward poor people in our country and around the world are more favorable than they were 15 years ago. There's been change in the religious community. There's been a big change among conservative evangelical Protestants, especially young evangelicals, especially over the last 10 years. That's a big deal. And in the last election, the voters elected as President of the United States an African American who knows what it is to receive food stamps and has deep roots in developing countries. Even 5 years ago, I wouldn't have imagined it. It's also no small matter that we have built Bread for the World into a stronger, more vibrant organization. The World Food Prize is a recognition of what all of us together have achieved for hungry people. And last year, 2010, we achieved more for poor and hungry people in Congress than in any previous year in our history. So we helped to pass the Child Nutrition Act, we helped to extend tax credits for the working poor. That one change is keeping 1 million kids out of poverty this year. That one change. We helped to launch the International Global Food Security Initiative, and we pushed the administration to get moving on foreign assistance reform. All that in 2010. So I think there is reason for hope, there is real momentum. But now we come to 2011, and to tell you about this, I will move over to my far right. But of course, it's no joking matter. It's true. You know, there are conservatives and there are conservatives. There are a lot of conservative people who fight for good programs that help poor and hungry people. But what's happening this year is that we are seeing a very severe and sustained attack on virtually everything the government does that provides help and opportunity to poor and hungry people in our own country and around the world. The U.S. House of Representatives has passed a budget that makes drastic cuts over 10 years in all government spending. And two-thirds of those cuts would hit programs that are focused on poor and hungry people. Two-thirds. It is just wrong. And that vision, then, is being played out in lots of specific decisions. So last week, for example, the House Appropriations Subcommittee for Agriculture passed a bill which will go to the floor of the House next week. Just that one sectoral appropriations bill would, in the next 12 months, throw 300,000 women and small children off the nutrition assistance that they receive from the WIC program. 300,000. The same agriculture appropriations bill would eliminate food aid for 14 million of the most desperate people in the world. Over the next 12 months, we're talking about. When the magnitude, the sweep of this threat became clear in March, Tony Hall and Jim Wallace and I, and then thousands of other people, entered into a time of fasting and prayer and advocacy. We need to ask God for help. We need to ask God to enter into our lives in a fuller way, and God to enter into the life of our country. Trying to reduce the deficit is not an easy matter, and the parties are very polarized. We need God to help us with this. Since then, lots and lots of other groups and individuals have joined together with us in trying to build a circle of protection around the programs that in the government's budget that are focused on poor and hungry people in our own country and around the world. If there are programs that need to be more effective, we'll help to fight to make them effective. That's what we're doing with foreign aid. Bread for the World's nationwide offering of letters this year is a push to get Republicans and Democrats to work together in this country to give foreign aid reform the force and durability of bipartisan law. As a country, we do need to reduce the federal deficit, but it is not necessary and it is not right to try to reduce the federal deficit at the expense of people who are having a hard time feeding their kids. I know that some of you have already had meetings with your members of Congress or their staff back in the districts. That is really important. And it's great that you're here right now, because as you know, Vice President Biden and congressional leaders are meeting in these days. And they are trying to hammer out right now the framework, an agreed framework, in which funding decisions will be made on lots of specific things over the next years. So when we go to the Hill on Tuesday, we're going to talk about the circle of protection. On Tuesday morning, you'll have a full briefing, so you'll be ready to go. But you couldn't be here at a more important time. The debate's not going to be over on Tuesday evening. You know, what we anticipate is that this same debate will play out in lots of ways, at least until the elections of 2012. So also when you go back home, you need to get you and your communities, your churches, need to speak to your members of Congress and insist that they protect hungry and poor people as we try to establish priorities for our nation. Now, before I quit, I want to talk a little bit about Jesus. Over the Christmas holidays, I read a book called American Grace. It's a sociological study of American religion. It's a thick thing, but it's pretty readable. And it's based on lots and lots of interviews, thousands and thousands of interviews and surveys with Americans about religion over a period of decades. And they had one finding there that just jumped out of the book. It jumped off the page. I thought that was so important. The authors of American Grace really don't make very much of this finding. But I managed to get them both on email on a Sunday afternoon to confirm that I really understood what they were saying and what the numbers behind that section in their book really are about. What they showed is that there is a statistical relationship, that those of us who experience God as a loving presence in our lives are more inclined to support government programs that help poor and hungry people. Now, you know, of course, you know, God loves me, God loves you. We know the same God loves alcoholics, the same God loves oppressed women on the other side of the world. If there are systems in place that can help those people, give them a better chance, do we want to support those systems? For the love of God, of course we do. It's not that everybody who believes in God supports government programs. 95% of Americans believe in God. And it's not that everybody who goes to church regularly or prays regularly supports government programs that help poor people. What's sad is that many of the people who go to church regularly do not experience God as a loving presence in their lives. Maybe they experience God as somehow remote, or at least not for them. And I think, truth be told, almost all of us sometimes feel like, geez, is God really there? Is God there for me? Does God like me? I mean, I think all of us need to hear that message over and over again, that God in Jesus Christ embraces us. As I try to figure out how we're going to change the politics of our country on this issue of hunger, it's just become clear to me that it can't happen unless lots and lots of people are moved by God's grace in Jesus Christ to get off the couch and make it happen. Now, let me be clear. God is graciously present in everybody's life, not just in the life of Christians. And Christians by ourselves aren't going to change our nation's politics. But the gospel of Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection is a very powerful message. Powerful. The message of the cross is that the forgiving death of Jesus is also God reaching out to us with forgiveness and grace to us and to all people. And Jesus, who rose from the dead 2,000 years ago, lives in us. We experience that. Jesus lives in and among us and is alive in the world. And so we can go out with the power of God's love to change the politics of hunger. If you believe that, we can go out with the power of God's love to change the politics of hunger. If you believe that, then let's all say together, Amen. Amen. And if you're ready to live that, then let's all shout together, Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Let us all stand and sing this hymn as a response to that wonderful message from our president. Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed. Let's sing praise God. Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. Amazing grace.
Thank you, David, for those words. Thank you, Victor, for the song. We have heard so many ways tonight that people are building momentum for change and have heard an invitation to join them in a movement based on God and based on God's love for us. Amen and amen. Now, those of you who have traveled long distances may want to go to bed about now. You're probably tired. And for those of you on West Coast time, or for those of you who are interested in informal conversation, if you'd like, you may come to the tavern, which is in the Mary Graydon Center, just at the junction between the buildings, where we will be having dessert and coffee. So you're welcome to come there. If you don't want to go, if you just want to go back to your rooms, you're also welcome to do that. We are going to reconverge together here tomorrow in this space at 8:45 a.m. There are two optional worship services at 8 a.m., a Catholic Mass, which will be in Butler, and a Protestant service in the SIS building. Both of those are on your campus maps. Let me close us today in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for calling each one here this evening and for the presence of your Spirit here. May these stories that we have heard settle deep into our hearts. May they lead us closer to you and encourage us in building your kingdom here on this earth. Amen. Amen. So we'll see you all here tomorrow.